ain't no love song, girl. This is a song for the G's. The bedroom G's. Usher.
It's right here. Welcome to episode 74 of the Online Strength Coach Podcast, Power Building. One of the most underrated and misunderstood geniuses of our time frame, ladies and gentlemen, Mark Morrison. Hope you're all keeping well. Today is Friday, the 12th of February, 2013. I just watched my team lose a heartbreaking fixture, which was hard to take. If you're listening to any of this, lads, you played awesome, and really is a shame that you lost, but well, it's the way the cookie crumbles sometimes. So yeah, if you listened to the last episode on DUP, then thanks for sticking through it. And today's question comes from Jim John again. Here are some ideas you could use for future videos. Don't need to answer them if you don't want to. Number one, power building. Incorporating powerlifting and bodybuilding. And there's four other topics that I might spread through the the year for more content for the podcast. Since the three people that listen to this, there's only seems to be a few, so many questions you can all ask. Also from episode 73, PL 700, fucking DUP, man. I agree. And also, apologies. Also from talking to a friend on Facebook, it would appear that some guy in England, our personal trainer from England, has written a book on DUP and managed to make 30 grand in the proceeds. Which is absolutely phenomenal, since Bill Kramer, the guy who pretty much invented the concept of DUP and wrote the first book on it, I'm pretty sure hasn't made anywhere near that sort of coin. So fair play to you, skinny man who writes stuff about lifting in England. Ooh, that's quite tender. Right, so yeah, power building. So power building is a concept that's been floating around the internet for quite a little while. It's basically, the thought is, it's a meld between bodybuilding and powerlifting. So you utilize primarily compound movements in high rep ranges. So you use things like back squat, bench press, deadlift, incline bench press, shoulder press. You know, the sort of major compound movements that powerlifters will use to train to become stronger for powerlifting, except on a high rep range sort of zone. So how does this relate to any other kind of training? I think this again can be related back to the DUP discussion. I think any kind of successful powerlifting program is going to incorporate quite a large amount of power building, as it were. There needs to be quite a lot of periods of high volume, high workload. Cross-sectional area is a hugely important factor for maximal strength, as we discovered in any one of the few DUP discussions or periodization discussions, or most of the podcasts that I went through. We discussed that volume and cross-sectional area of muscle is quite a large factor, quite an important factor when it comes to actually producing force or being as strong as you possibly can. Obviously, within bodybuilding, there is absolutely no onus on how strong you are. It doesn't matter. You can have some lifters like Ron Coleman, who are just absolutely phenomenally strong. You know, videos of him deadlifting 360 for two, squatting 360 for two, front squatting 260 for four or five, benching 220 for four or five reps. And you get other bodybuilders like Sakai Green, who don't really lift heavy, don't really do squats, lift kind of high high rep, slow load, kind of concentrate primarily on the mind-muscle connection, as they call it. And a lot of things within bodybuilding can get lost because of the amount of drug use that goes on. And also a lot of these guys don't really tell you how they got there in the first place. So the likes of Mike Metzger, to use the kind of the first guy to go off the beaten path, as it were, and kind of push a training methodology that maybe he didn't really utilize to get where he was. Mike Metzger didn't get in the shape that you see him in the books and like the high intensity training books. He didn't get in that shape utilizing high intensity training. He got in that shape utilizing traditional sort of bodybuilding methodology. Barbell lifts, high rep sets, training to failure, large amounts of exercise variety, large amounts of exercise volume. That's how a man of that ilk or a man of that size got there. sorry about this cough, I got a tickle in my throat. Now, a man who looks like that decides to go off the beaten path, produce a training system, produce a book, produce an article series, produce basically something that's a USP or a unique selling point within the market. If everyone else, like the example of Bill Starr's pushing 5x5 or Arnold Schwarzenegger's pushing traditional body parts splits using barbells, sets of 8 to 12, 4 to 5 sets, 8 to 12 reps. Franco Colombo was pushing the same sort of thing at the time. And then if a guy comes out who looks really good, you know, won Mr. Universe a few times, comes out and says, here's a revolutionary training methodology that is going to produce the results that you desire, that you see. Look at me as Mike Metzger, look at my shape, this is how I achieve this shape. Then he's going to stand out because he goes against the grain. Anyone who goes against the grain of communication will automatically stand out. So it becomes popular, people pick it up. A lot of people, when it comes to training and strength training, are lay. A lot of the people who are actively interested and engaged in strength training are lay as well. Although the actual ins and outs of strength training and exercise physiology are out there to be seen by everybody, and not actually, as far as science goes, they're very uncomplicated, very simplistic when it comes to the actual ins and outs of how programs work, how strength training works, how the biological systems respond to stress to become stronger or fitter. It's a very straightforward process, and when you understand the process, it's very easy to stick to it and to repeatedly produce results. However, when you don't have clarity in that process, it's very easy to follow someone like Mike Metzger down the line of the likes of high intensity training, which is complete nor gobbledygook. The thought that someone could train 1 to 2 sets, 2 to 3 times a week to failure and produce like optimum results has been categorically refuted within the research. One of the popular hypertrophy or strength training topics of like the late 90s, early 2000s was multi-set versus single-set training. And it's one of the few things actually that has been borne through meta-analysis and systematic review is that more volume or multi-set training is not only better for strength, but also much better for hypertrophy. One of the common things you'll see for hypertrophy training is volume of work completed is the most important thing when it comes to hypertrophy. Volume of work completed is ultimately the factor that you need to push up and push through. So the more volume of bench press or the more volume of pressing horizontally and in other planes for the chest and shoulder muscles that you can perform in the week and get better at, or sorry, not and get better at, but recover from and have the necessary sleep and the necessary nutrition and the necessary endocrine system involvement to not only recover but also super compensate from and eventually gain a little bit of muscle here and there and, you know, get stronger and get bigger. the better a bodybuilder you want to be. Now, we went off on a bit of a tangent there. But when it comes to powerbuilding is not really a new concept. Powerbuilding is basically bodybuilding in its oldest guise. We utilize bench press, squat, deadlift. All of the old-time bodybuilders utilize those lifts. Pretty much 90% of bodybuilders who aren't elite, who are coming through the ranks. So the next Ronnie Coleman, the next Branch Warren, the next Flex Wheeler, the next Dorian Yates, they're training somewhere in a gym somewhere in the world right now, training with back squat, bench press, deadlift, barbell row, chin-ups, pull-ups, Milliray press. They're using dumbbells of failure. They're utilizing the methods of training that actually result in hypertrophy, that actually result in you getting bigger. No, they train 4 to 5 sets, 8 to 12 reps. Now they try to get stronger within those rep ranges. And that's pretty much how, within that sort of guideline or that frame of reference or that way of working, if you have, let's call it, so one of the rep ranges or one of the sets and rep schemes that I use quite commonly is what the first sets and rep scheme that I was ever made aware of, that I ever utilized, is 1 set of 12, 1 set of 10, 1 set of 8, 1 set of 6, all done as heavy as possible for those sets and reps. And if you make all the sets and reps in the workout, so for example, on a bench press, if I bench 100 for 12, 105 for 10, 110 for 8, 115 for 6, then I would increase the weight on all of those lifts next workout, which would typically be a week. So it would be Monday to Monday. So next Monday, we go up 105 for 12, 110 for 9, say, 115 for 7, and 120 for 5, say. Then the next week, the only weight that I would move up would be the set that I made. So I'd maybe go start off on 107, maybe go 12, and then go 110 for 10, yada yada. So you get in a scenario where we were training sets of 12, sets of 10, sets of 8, sets of 6. We're training at RMs for those loads. So that means an RM of 12 is 70%, an RM of 10 is 75%, an RM of 8 is 80%. Sorry, is it 78%, and RM of 6 is about 82%. This cough's really annoying. So we have a set of reps spread there from 70-82%, which we can actually get stronger at, but it's quite a good payoff. It's kind of the sweet spot when we look at volume load, and volume load is the thing we need to push in bodybuilding to get bigger. So volume is the amount of reps that we complete in the workout, and obviously the load or the intensity is the weight that we shift. Those two combined makes up volume load, and volume load is the mechanical stressor that ultimately really determines the amount of hypertrophy that we get. And if we do this with large compound movements, then we end up with power building, as it's termed, or also what it was called back in the day, is just bodybuilding or lifting weights. There was a reason that Arnold Schwarzenegger could win the German powerlifting championships back in the day. Well, apart from the one, he's probably the only person doing it. But bodybuilders should be strong. They just train with higher rep ranges. Powerlifters and bodybuilders shouldn't be too far removed, really, until it gets to like the ultra elite stage, when they're really specialized towards one or the other. So if you look at a good example would be Andrei Milanichev, when he's about 18 to 20, and Arnold Schwarzenegger, when they're about 18 to 20. Size-wise, body-wise, they're both probably quite similar in how they look. Both quite lean, both very muscular, both very strong. Strength-wise, Milanichev is probably a little bit stronger, but you know, there's not a hell of a lot to choose between them. Probably in the squat, there's quite a bit. Between bench press and deadlifts, probably not a lot to choose there. And then if we look at them when they're 40, so when Arnold when he's 40, or what's probably a little late for Arnold, let's look at them when they're 30. So Milanichev when he's 30 and Arnold when he's 30. The Milanichev's physique, hypertrophy-wise, the torso's probably not changed a lot. It's probably just got a little bit softer. His thighs, though, are much more pronounced, like, hypertrophied. Arnold's whole physique is much more hypertrophied. This should be the stage when he's like 7th, probably wearing his 6th Olympia win, probably when he's at his peak, probably that's around the time, or not around the time, it's probably the time that Pumping Iron was filmed. You know, Arnold never historically had a massive pair of legs, but his torso probably stands up to modern torsos, probably a bit less blocky and a bit less muscularly defined, but it's certainly, it's not, considering that he's about 30 years ago compared to the pros now, it certainly stands up to scrutiny. So if you look at the two physiques, Milanichev has probably actually regressed a little bit in his upper body when they both probably had a little bit of parity there. Arnold's past where he was, he is much bigger, much thicker, much fuller. He's developed a lot more. His legs have improved, whereas Milanichev's legs have improved a lot more. Like, his body comp's a lot lower, so a lot of that size probably is bloof. But the strength levels, Milanichev's strength level now far outstrips that of, it's not Klokhanov, but does that, far outstrips that of Arnold Schwarzenegger. When muscularly, Arnold Schwarzenegger's probably gained more total mass, but probably less leg mass than Andrei Milanichev's happened. What's changed here? Where have they went with the training? Well, Milanichev has went down a 3-lift routine and done it to the point where he's specialised in those lifts. He's got a high skill component and he can produce high forces within those movements because he's highly skilled. He has large cross-sectional areas in the motor units and the muscles that are involved in those specific 3 lifts, so those 3 motor patterns, squat, bench and deadlift. Whereas Arnold Schwarzenegger has developed in a huge tree of movements. You know, he does incline bench, decline bench, flat bench, dumbbell fly, decline dumbbell fly, cable fly, high to low fly, low to high fly, press ups, dips, tricep dips, shoulder press, barbell. You know, he probably name off about 25 lifts that Arnold does on a regular basis for pressing the muscles of the upper body, shoulders and chest mainly, and also a little bit of triceps. And that's not including isolation movements that he does for triceps. You could probably name at least 10 to 15, if not 20 movements that he probably uses on a regular basis for the tricep, either directly or indirectly. Whereas Milanichev utilizes 3, and he might have a bank of 10 to 20 assistance movements that he uses all round, but it is unlikely that he utilizes them in a real manner within his training. That's powerlifting versus bodybuilding. Powerbuilding is like the midway. Powerbuilding is basically a good weight training program. It's a very good weight training program, and it's, and it can get you far away. For a powerlifter, it can build a very good base level of strength and give you a very good launching point from where you can have a good powerlifting career. Power building is pretty much how I got my base. Power building, that 12, 10, 8, 6 program, I did that for squat, bench, and deadlift. That took me up to probably about 600 total, which is, at 90 kilos, is not stellar, but it's a fairly reasonable base from which to lift from. And then from then, I specialize on the powerlifting. Whereas, you know, with bodybuilding, you could probably get right up to, like, the highest levels. Maybe not the highest levels, but you can certainly get to within the threshold of the highest levels utilizing those basic techniques and steroids. That will take you to the Mr. Universe sort of level, or the pro card level. And to get past the pro card level, well, I don't know if that means you need to take more steroids or you need to look more at your training or how that works out, because obviously I'm not that level of bodybuilder. But, you know, power building is basically a sound weight training routine, It could take you very far on either end. Hope you've enjoyed that podcast. That concludes episode 74. If you have any questions or comments, please leave them below. If you're on, you listen to this on YouTube, please like and subscribe. If you listen to this on iTunes, please give us a 5-star review. Listen to this on SoundCloud. God bless you. You're probably the only one. Thank you very much for listening. Thank you very much for listening. I've been Marquise, and I will leave you with the 90s version of Beethoven, also known as Mark Marshall. Oh, no.